Where is the Ark of the Covenant? If you watched TV last night, the Raiders of the Lost Ark was on at 8 o'clock last night.
Where was it?
We learned where it was, and you can watch it here. Turn the volume up. It's not back there. This is the very end of the movie. All right, now we know where it is. No, you can't go home. Just in case it went too fast for you to read, on the side was stenciled, top secret, Army Intelligence, number 067753, do not open. Knowing that information that we just saw on the screen doesn't help us to know where the mark of where the Ark of the Covenant is located. And to find out, or at least to attempt to find out, we need to ask ourselves a number of questions, such as, and I put together a list here. Was the Ark captured by an enemy of Israel? Or was it destroyed during the destruction of the temple by Babylon in 586 BC? Or was it placed in a hiding place and then lost because nobody knew where they had been hidden? Was it put into hiding so that, I already did that one. Okay. Was it whisked out of the country by a friend or an enemy? But that friend there. Does it really matter what happened to the Ark?
One behind.
I'm one behind. Thank you. If it is found today, what would it do to Israel's society? How would it affect Israel today if in fact it was found? I'm not going to answer that question today. The Bible really doesn't give us any direction on this, where it might be. We can look at some scriptures. But it just doesn't say, well, it was destroyed, or it was raptured to heaven, or it was hidden in the cave. It doesn't say anything like that to help us understand where to go to look. And people are looking in a lot of places, or they have looked in a lot of places. I don't know if they're still looking in a lot of places. But there are a number of sites that they have investigated. Let me just put them on the screen there. That it's at the Dead Sea, or it's up in Gedi, that's near the Dead Sea. The Mount of Olives, Mount Nebo, Abu Ghosh, West Bank Village, Egypt, Ethiopia, Knights Templar, Cathedral in France, at a castle in Ireland, at the Vatican, or in the temple, under the temple in some kind of tunnel. We're not going to look at all those. I'm going to put a star besides those that we are going to look at, and we won't look at all those today. We'll look at three or four, and I might add some next week, depending on our time. But today we have the luncheon afterwards, so you want to make sure we're finished. We do know one thing about the Ark. We know that in the 11th year of King Solomon's reign, it was put in the temple. You can read that, and I have a scripture on that. Go ahead. It says, I think, in 1 Kings 8:6. Then the priest brought in the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place, into the inner sanctuary of the temple, the most holy place, under the wings of the cherubim. So we know at that point it was in the temple, in the most holy place, the Holy of Holies, during the time of Solomon. This scripture is referring to the dedication of the temple after it had been built by Solomon. And so once we have that scripture, and even though the Ark is mentioned 174 times in the Old Testament, after this scripture, there's only one more time in the Old Testament that's mentioned at all. So we don't have a whole lot of information as to things that happened to it. Was it actually put in hiding? So we're going to look at some of the theories and find out. The one time that's mentioned after Solomon was during the reign of King Josiah. King Josiah was the last godly king of Judah. And, I think I have something that we have here for him. It says this, and when it says, then he, that's King Josiah, and he said of the Levites who taught Israel, who were holy to the Lord, put the holy ark into the house which Solomon, the son of David, king of Israel, built. It shall no longer be a burden on your shoulders. Now serve the Lord your God and his people, Israel. What we have here is very interesting, and this is the last place that Ark is mentioned in the Old Testament. Very interesting. First of all, it says that sometimes it took the Ark out of the temple. We're not given the reasons for that. There are speculations among theologians that whenever there was an ungodly king that brought in all kinds of idols and other things into the temple, that they took the Ark out. Other than that, I don't know of any other logical reason, but there, by this scripture, it says, now put it back in to the temple. However, if you think that it says didn't say put it back in the temple, it says put it back in the house that Solomon, the son of David, built. Jewish theologians take that as they're taking it out of the temple and putting it in another house that Solomon built. That's different than most Christians believe that he's commanding them to put it back in. Whichever way, this is the last time that we hear about the Ark in the Old Testament. I want to show you here where King Josiah, you can look on there, and I'll on that foot, the mouse. Where is Josiah? Right here. He reigns from 640 to 609. Also, look up here, where the Babylonian captivity began in 606 to 536. He was the last godly king. There were three more kings after him that were ungodly, and one of them was assassinated, was killed by Nebuchadnezzar. So this is happening sometime during the reign of Josiah, that he's telling them, put it back in or take it out. Some would say it could be taken out because the prophet Jeremiah, which is right here, rang in. Oh, excuse me. Let me take that back. He prophesied up through part of that Babylonian captivity. He dies two years after the temple was destroyed in 586. He dies in 584. So it gives an idea, and Jeremiah will come up in one of the other theories that I'll give you in just a few minutes. Josiah. That's the last we hear. For some reason, it's out. It can be taken out, and we're not told why. Any questions on that? All right. Let me take you to Ireland. Some might say, well, how can Ireland ever be the place? Well, there's a group over there. They're called British Israelites. I've spoken to you not recently about Christian organizations that believe the 10 lost tribes of Israel are found in the British Commonwealth. So all of British Commonwealth, all the countries they had, Canada, Australia, those kind of countries are the remains of the 10 lost tribes. I don't believe that. But there are a number of organizations, Christian organizations, that do. That doesn't make them heretical. It's just that they're often what they believe about, because those same groups are anti-Semitic. They don't believe the Israel over there in the Middle East is real Israel. They are real Israel. So there's a castle in the small hills there in Ireland that they say that the Ark of the Covenant is in that castle. If I bring a little closer, you can see a castle inside one of those loops. And a couple of roads that come out of there as well. So other than the fact that they are British Israelites, which I think is a false doctrine, but not heretical, just wrong, I'm not going to spend any more time on that one unless you have a question. All right, let's go to another site called Mount Nebo. There's one Jewish tradition that there are a number of Jewish people who believe this. This is not the main one that most Jewish people believe, but this is important in that, as I mentioned a minute ago, there's going to be one of these theories has Jeremiah in mind, and it's this one. Since Jeremiah was the prophet, and he was the one prophet at home in Jerusalem, whereas Daniel and Ezekiel, they were all both taken to Babylon, Jeremiah stayed in Jerusalem. In fact, for a while there, he was in prison in Jerusalem. And he knew the coming of the Babylonian captivity. He wrote about the 70 years in Jeremiah 25, verse 11, I think it is. He told the people it's going to last for 70 years. And he would be the logical person if there's going to be somebody to take the Ark of the Covenant and try to hide it, because there's an impending danger of the Babylonians come in, it would be Jeremiah. We have no idea of that in Scripture, though. So, where do they get this idea? If you have a Catholic background, you are familiar with the apocryphal books. These are the number of books that are written between the Old and the New Testaments. If you're not aware, the Old Testament ends about 430 years before Christ. So there's about 400 years that is blank in the life of Israel during that time, except from other historical sites. Some of those books are Tobit and 1st, 2nd, 3rd, and 4th, Maccabees, Judith, and several other books that are written. And they're called Apocrypha, by the way. Let me give you a little sidestep here. The word Apocrypha means hidden. What's the antitype or the opposite of apocrypha?
Sacred.
What?
Secret.
Secret. No, I want the opposite of being secret. The opposite of being hidden.
Found.
Actually, I'll start it in Greek. It's found in the first verse of the book of Revelation. It's called Apocalypsis, or in English, the Apocalypse, the revelation of Jesus Christ. Whereas one hides it, the Apocalypse unveils it. It makes it not hidden. Just thought I'd throw that in. It's not my notes. But the second book of the Maccabees is where you find this theory. Mount Nebo, how many of you have been at the top of Mount Nebo? Several, yes. I've been there three times, and this is a photo taken from the top of Mount Nebo, and trying to give you some landmarks across the Dead Sea. It's near the northern end of the Dead Sea, and I put Jericho there because there's one Bible verse that says, refers to Mount Nebo as being that which is opposite of the Jordan River from Jericho. And then I think, the Jordan River there as well, that comes into the Dead Sea. Second Maccabees says this, and if you read the entire chapter 2 of Second Maccabees, you get an even broader picture, but let me read this one verse. After Jeremiah came to the mountain, he found a big cave, where he hid the tent, the chest would be the Ark of the Covenant, and the altar for burning incense. Then he blocked the entrance of the cave. So that's where this theory comes from. It's from the second Maccabees book. We don't have the Apocrypha in most of our Bibles because we don't hold them in the same, and I don't think the Catholics do either, but don't hold them in the same level as the canon of Scripture as being inspired by God. So they do sometimes have good historical references. Any question on this theory?
John?
Yes?
I was always told that you couldn't preach the birth, death, burial, and resurrection from the apocryphal books.
That's a good point. She's saying that she was told that you can't preach the death, burial, resurrection of Jesus Christ from the apocryphal books, and I think that's accurate. Yeah.
And there's also the pseudepigrapha, which is even more a story.
Okay, I have to explain now. She mentions the pseudepigrapha. The word pseudepigrapha, pseudo means false, pigrapha means name. So it's false named. So we have the Gospel of Peter, for instance. We don't have the Gospel of Peter. We have his epistle. But we don't have a Gospel of Peter. That's some of the pseudepigrapha books. And there are a lot of them. The book, I'm trying to think of the book that took Dan Brown, who wrote it. The Da Vinci Code? He takes a lot of these pseudepigraph books and tries to make a theory that they should be included as part of the Word of God. And they were found way up the Nile River in Egypt. Okay, let's go to the opposite side of the Dead Sea. I think maybe I've already discussed that. Let me see. Yeah, I have. Let's go to the other side, over near Qumran, where they found the Dead Sea Scrolls. They've never found the Ark of the Covenant in any of those caves, but that's one of the old theories, is that it was hidden away in one of those caves near what today is called Qumran, and hidden there and is never found. And I'm going to show you a couple of pictures here. I hope you can see that. You can see that there's a cave there on the side. This is, happens to be cave number 3 of the Dead Sea Scrolls. And look on top of the mountain, right above it. You can see it's caved in into the cave. All right? When I went there in 2003, the first time I went to Israel, it wasn't caved in. So it's all caved in the last 15 years or so. And that happens in a number of cases over years. Caves will do that. There's all kinds of erosion. And possible that one of the caves that was, this is talking about, that the ark was put into, was that, and all fell in upon itself and maybe never found, that somebody just happens to dig in that area. So, let's see what else. I thought I had some. No.
Doesn't that make sense, though, since the scrolls were found there? That kind of makes sense.
It does, but only if you, in a way it does. I would say because these scrolls are primarily related to a group of people that were kind of a side group of Jewish society, and the reason, some call them the Essenes, and that might be true, but it's a group of people who differed on wanting to have the holy days every year than just most of the Jews that were in Jerusalem. And so now if it was in one of those caves, I would say, well, that's the Essenes that used that would have done it. And that's possible, but I don't think they had access to get the cave, to get the ark, but I'm not sure. There's a hand.
So speaking of the caves of Qumran and the Dead Sea Scrolls, there was also the Copper Scroll.
I'm not going to get into any of the Dead Sea Scrolls today.
No, I was just going to say, are you going to speak about the Copper Scroll?
No, I'm not.
Supposedly, talks about where it is.
The Copper Scroll is a list of all different kinds of sites that they think not only was the Ark maybe one of them at one of those places, but lots of money. And the Copper Scroll has never been found, even though they've searched and searched and searched. There are some Copper Scrolls that have been found, but not those Copper Scrolls. Yeah. All right. Ethiopia. Yes. This is the most looked at theory of them all, other than one I'll get to next year. Next year, yeah. Next year. Freudian slip there. And I'm surprised by a number of biblical scholars, prophecy experts, that actually do accept this theory. That the ark is in a church in Ethiopia. Let me take you through the story. The story, it sounds reasonable, but it's not mentioned in the Bible. The story goes like this. While Solomon was king, he had visits from all kinds of dignitaries while he was king. One of those was the Queen of Sheba. And the Queen of Sheba came to visit him and was here for some time and marveled that what she saw that King Solomon had far surpassed anything that she had been told. The story goes like this, is that they had a sexual relationship. And they had, and then the Queen of Sheba goes home and is there while in Ethiopia that she has a child. She has a child, his name is Menelik. Later on, as kings and go on in Ethiopia, he becomes known as Menelik the First. He grows up, and at some age, 8, 9 years old, he is sent by the Queen of Sheba back to Solomon in order to learn the Jewish religion. And he's there until about age 19, when the theory says he sees that the kingdom of Israel is fractured, and it has. And as soon as Solomon gives up his throne, Israel is divided into 2 tribes and 10 tribes under Rehoboam, who is the son of Solomon, and Jeroboam, the other one. So Menelik sees that happening already before Solomon dies, and he takes the ark for safekeeping and takes it home. But on the way, they stop at an island in the Nile River that's called Elephantine Island. And you will find there, and this is a sketch of the ruins, of the temple that's very much like the Temple of Solomon. It has 2 parts on the intersection of that temple, the Holy of Holies and the Holy Place. And I don't know how long they were there, but then they take the ark to Ethiopia, to Aksum. There's two different ways to spell Aksum on this map. It's A-K-S-U-M. Most places I see it A-X-U-M. It's kind of pronounced the same way though, Aksum. And it's very, very much the northern border of Ethiopia. And you can see the other countries there. The Red Sea. I don't know if I have anything else on this. And yes, I did. And this is the church in which it is held and guarded. It is really guarded like Fort Knox. Nobody has access except the one person into the inner parts of this church in Aksum. Trying to see if there's anything else I need about this. How are we doing in time?
Plenty.
Plenty? Or 20? I'd rather have plenty.
No, I'm just saying this is a story, right? It's not scripture.
This is not Christian. It's not biblical, let me put it that way. There are Christians who believe it. That doesn't mean if you believe it that you're a heretic. They should say, I believe you're wrong. But I have people that I respect, and I was reading some of them just this week that do hold and feel that that may be really the place where it is being held. And I'm not sure at what time it's supposed to be brought back. I don't have any idea of that. This is called the Chapel of the Tablets. Now, the Bible does show that there is a link, a friendly link, between Israel and Ethiopia in the Bible. Not just the Queen of Sheba, but how about Aaron and Miriam? They got angry at Moses. You know why they got angry at Moses? Maybe I have a scripture, maybe I don't. They got angry at Moses because he married an Ethiopian. There's one other. How about the Ethiopian eunuch and Philip? He is leaving Jerusalem, and God tells Philip to go down where he was, and he was in the Gaza area at the time, what we call Gaza, and heading south, heading home. Why was he in Jerusalem? He was a high official of the queen, whose name was Candace, the Bible tells us. Could he actually be a Jew that had come for the holy days, as all men Jews are supposed to do each year, to each of the three different holy days that God required that of? And to show that there's some authenticity in that thought is, on three different occasions, Ethiopians have made, well, on one occasion, Ethiopians have made a request of Israel, saying, we have a number of Jews down here that we'd like to move to Israel, like other Jews are moving to Israel. And it took a couple years, I think, Jews realized we have some black Jews down there, and they are authentic Jews. Now the story goes all the way back to Queen Sheba to start that, is the story. But nevertheless, Israel is very particular about authenticating real Jews and letting them immigrate. And they had an operation where they sent in airplanes to fly them out and come to Israel. That was called the Operation of Moses. Then, just a short time later, Operation of Joshua, they got 800 more. And the big one came a few years later when Israel sent in, over a 48-hour period, sent in dozens of airplanes in Operation Solomon, and taking out 14,000 people that were authenticated to be Jewish. And they are now living in Israel. So there's been this kind of relationship between Ethiopia and Israel for a long, long time. Yes, John.
Legally, to be accepted as a Jewish person in Israel, you have to be at least 1/16.
Yep, that's good. John says you have to have at least 1/16 Jewish blood to be allowed. Is that to be a citizen? Excuse me? Aliyah? Yeah, when you make an Aliyah, Aliyah is a migration of Jews into. John's become very familiar. He has a son-in-law that's Jewish. And he has, because of that, they live in Haifa. And he has a granddaughter that's now in the IDF. So we have a representative here of the IDF. So, yeah. So, 1/16. I did not know that. That's good. Let me pray. Thank you, Lord, for all that you do for us. We are, of all people, most blessed. We love you, Lord. I pray, Lord, you be with this people as they leave this room. May you orchestrate their steps, guide them, protect them from the ways of the enemy. May you lighten the path that they walk. We love you and want to praise you and please you in all that we do. And we give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We love you.